All right, so start with the session. We'll quickly review the learning objectives for today. So basically, we'll have a look at how maps can be used in DHIS2 and how we can use the maps to analyze data through different layers. So GIS, in terms of its overview, is quite broad. It's a vast topic in itself, but the focus that we will have today is on the Maps app, which is kind of a concise GIS built within the DHIS2 system. So we will kind of try to look at the possibilities of data analysis using maps and different layers within DHIS2, which may not fulfill the entire scope of services which a broader geographic information system provides. So our focus would entirely lie on what functionalities and what kind of analysis is possible using the Maps app in DHIS2. So we will be demonstrating different functions available in the Maps application. So we'll go through the Maps app interface in terms of what selections available, what features available, and what each function contributes to in the overall analysis function. Then we'll be talking about thematic layers, which are basically layering your data or one over the other into in different layers using different indicators or different data elements. So it's all about thematic layers when we talk about aggregate data. So we could plot the data into these thematic layers at different levels in the hierarchy. So depending upon how the analysis has been set up, the GIS has been set up in the DHIS2. Based on that, you are able to perform the levels of analysis using different layers in the application. Then we discussed about legends in both the pivot table and the visualizer session. So legends have a key role to play in the Maps app as well. So we'll have a look at the automatic legends which are available, the predefined legends which could be configured. So both we'll discuss during the course of the session. Then we'll have a look at the next two type of layers supported, which is the boundary and the facility layers. So boundary layers are basically the administrative geographies or boundaries for different administrative areas in your country. And facility is the individual health center or a hospital. So how we could layer these on the Maps app. Then how can we utilize customized legends into our analysis? So we'll have focus on that. Then along with the maps, there is also a supportive data table available. So we'll have a look how we can review the data table in congruence with the map that we have developed. And then there are certain views available which kind of add more value to the analytical object or the map which you have created through the use of split views, the timeline view. And bubble maps have been newly introduced in version 2.35. So we'll have a look at that as well. So in terms of nutshell, what the DHIS2 maps allows you to do is to create thematic maps of area and points. So you could create your thematic layers or layering of data one on top of each other to kind of analyze different indicators through either use of the areas, which are your polygons, which could be your administrative areas, it could be region, it could be districts, it could be blocks, and it could be drilled down till the facility level also. So your areas are basically your administrative areas, like your districts, blocks, and your points are basically your health facilities at which you could analyze the data. Then you could view facilities based on their classification. So a facility can be grouped by its type, by its ownership, by the areas it lies into. Maybe it's an urban facility or a rural facility. So accordingly, just give me one moment. So you can group your health facilities based on different classifications. So you can either classify your health facilities by their type, by the ownership, or by the area they lie into. So you could view those facilities based on these classifications. Then with the map, you can also have a look at the underlying data which is associated. So it could be the data for facilities infrastructure or data for population or other variables which you want to kind of utilize with them, with the indicators or data elements that you're trying to talk. Then you could download the map for offline use. So if you want to use the maps which you have created for your presentations or your external documents, then you can download images and use those images in your external documents. Then there is also a feature which allows you to download the map data into a shareable format, which could allow you to import the map data into different other external GIS applications such as QGIS. So if you want to do some sort of advanced analysis which is not available in DHIS2, and you kind of have expertise on other GIS softwares, then you could download data from DHIS2 and use that data in other software such as QGIS or ArcGIS. So these are the key functionalities which are available in the maps application in DHIS2. So basically the maps app allows you to do a spatial representation of data. So, and kind of they're more tangible to the end users because they're able to clearly highlight or clearly see the areas within the old health system which needs more focus depending upon how you are analyzing your indicators. So if you want to show or highlight the problem areas, for example, for any program, if you want to see the coverage of certain vaccines, say the BCG immunization, or even for now, the larger focus is on the COVID vaccinations, so you want to see what areas have more vaccination coverage, what areas have less vaccination coverage, a map kind of gives you a very clear picture of what's happening on the field. What are the areas which are producing good results? What are the areas which need more focus? So kind of the outcome of the data on the map is more tangible, and it's easy to share the present situation with the stakeholders and decision makers. So they're able to quickly see which particular geographic areas need more intervention or may need more support, and then how our interventions could be directed to those areas to kind of improve the performance of those respective facilities or those respective districts. Then it's very easy to overlap information one over the other. So if they are contributing factors for an indicator where you want to see if there are less number of COVID cases being reported in a certain geography, then we could correlate that whether a good amount of testing is really being done in those areas or not. Okay, because these are proportional. So if you're doing low testing, then of course you'll get low positives. But then if the testing is done adequately and there are less results, that means the infection is contained to a certain extent. But then if you are doing larger testing and there are larger positives being identified, then it's kind of runs in proportion that because the testing is inadequately, hence you're able to identify a good number of positive cases. So there you are kind of using information by different information in different layers, and you're overlapping them to kind of see that what are the areas which need more support or any intervention needs to be carried out for that specific area or not. And then if there are relationships available which, in terms of spatially between the different public health concepts, then of course you would utilize those concepts and apply those concepts on the maps and come out with an interpretation that based on the analysis which has been carried out, these are the areas which are of concern, and these are the geographic areas which need more help in terms of providing more resources or kind of giving them more support so that their performance can improve over time. So the different layerings we see, for example, in DHIS2, we kind of focus on the boundary layers, the thematic layers, and the facility layers. So you in order to generate a map, you need to understand the layers available in the system. And in terms of configuration, when we are configuring the map, the GIS, we kind of use these different layers to kind of import these coordinates against each of the administrative areas. So when we talk about facility, then that's a point layer. So in order to generate data at the facility level, we need to have facility coordinates available in the system. Similarly, for district and provinces, those would be the shape files, which basically have these polygons inbuilt. And then these polygons kind of come up, and these polygons are shown on the maps app as the district and the province layers, so on which the data gets plotted. Now you can overlay the data between these thematic layers. So if I want to see the overall testing done for HIV in all the health facilities, then I'm using the facility as one of the layers where I'm plotting my data. Then I want to see how many positive HIV cases have been identified as an outcome of the testing. That I want to see overall at the district level. Then I can use the district level. And then I can use these two layers to overlap them to kind of see the data between overall testing done and overall positivity. So I can plot the data using these different layers and then use those layers to kind of see data for two different indicators together. So each layer will have the boundaries and the data elements associated with it. So when we go into the demonstration, we'll see that when we are setting up each layer, we are selecting that at what level we are trying to analyze the data and for what data elements of what for indicators for what period we are analyzing the data. So we'll see these details as we go ahead. So in terms of the overall look and feel of the Maps app, so the Maps app looks like this, where you have functionalities to add different layers. So you have add layer button on the top, which kind of gives you access to the layers which are available in the system. And then you have a base layer, which is integrated with the Bing maps and also the OpenStreetMaps, where you have these different layers which are kind of from the base of your map. So you could select any of these pre-available base maps, but it is also possible to import external base maps. So if you have any other satellite imagery or any other external base maps available, those also can be imported and can be utilized for plotting your data. This is your map display area, where the dimensions or the layers that you select, they get populated. And this is your selection area, where you make all the selections which are required for your spatial data analysis. So base map layers are represented by these layer cards in the layer panel. So these are the ones which are available. In case you do not want the base map to be shown at all, then you can toggle on this I option, this view option. This will disable the base map layer altogether. So you will not see any base map layer in case you do not want these layers to be shown on your map display area. Then within the map layers which are available in DHIS2 in the Maps app, you have through this academy, we'll focus more on the aggregate data analysis using the Maps app. So when you're analyzing your aggregate data, you use three layers primarily. So one is a facility layer, one is a thematic layer, and one is a boundary layer. We'll see the function of each of these layers moving forward in the demonstration. So based on your requirement, you can choose the layer and manage the dimensions which you want to see in these respective layers. So for example, this is end output of a thematic map, which we can plot in the system, where we are analyzing that what was the coverage of the measles rubella first dose in the last month. And at the district level, so you're able to see the ones which are in red, these are the low coverage districts. There are five districts which are falling under low coverage, three districts which are under mid coverage between 70 to 80%. There are two districts which are on high, two on highest, and one there is no district which is under invalid or showing data greater than 100%. So like this, you can create your thematic layers, your thematic maps into the system by utilizing the different selections available in the Maps app. And this is an example of your end product, which is available. So this map could be then saved as a favorite, can be put on a dashboard, can be downloaded as an image, and can be utilized for further documentation as well. Then each of the map which you create is supported by a data table. So for the map, data table gets generated, which has these additional filters on the top. So you can add dynamic filters here, and the map and the table both will get updated based on the updates which you do in the table itself. So if you want to play around with the map, add some combinations of data, which may or may not be part of a legend, then you could also pass on dynamic ranges as well here. So if you want to see, districts falling between, say, greater than 65 but less than 85, then you can put these combinations of data into the value field, and the map and the table will get automatically updated based on the conditions that you pass into the Maps app. So there are a few considerations which you need to take into account when we are talking about the Maps application. So of course, for any visualization that we do, we covered a lot of these concepts during the visualization session, where we kind of were choosing what are the best mechanism to show a kind of data to different visualizations available. So the same concepts apply here as well. You need to take into your audience into account when you're creating your maps, whether these the maps give adequate information to the audiences for which you're creating these visualizations. Then the type and the purpose of data, whether the kind of data that you're plotting is easily representable and understandable through the maps that you're creating. So we need to take into account that as well. Then you have the nature of data relationship being presented. For example, if you want to see the testing versus positives phenomena, so that's one thing which you can take into account. So whenever you are overlapping your layers, you need to ensure that the layers that you're overlapping do hold a valid relationship in between, or the data can be related and can be further analyzed upon. So that needs to be taken into account. And the last is the accuracy and the applicability of the map. So since a lot of this GIS configuration happens through the shapefiles and the coordinates which are already available with many of the organizations, so these configurations are done beforehand the Maps application can be used. Therefore, the accuracy in that process when you're doing the configuration of the Maps app holds a key importance in the final output. So we need to ensure that, first of all, when we are configuring the Maps app, the administrative boundaries, that the source files which we're using for configuration do have the correct data, and they kind of show the exact geographical situation which is there on ground in the system as well. So these are some of the considerations which you need to take into account when we are talking about the Maps applications. So there are some questions that we'll try to answer moving forward, that how can maps help you to communicate more effectively? For example, we saw in one of the examples that we used in the presentation in the past was for the MR1 coverage. So through this map, I was very easily able to identify the districts which have low coverage. And now I know that these districts have low coverage, so I can try to do targeted interventions for these districts specifically to see what are the factors which are contributing to such low coverages. Are stocks an issue, or supply chain management an issue, or human resources an issue, or any other thing which is hampering the districts to perform better in terms of covering the vaccinations? So it kind of showed me the problem areas, the geographic areas which have issues more prominently, so that I could focus more on finding solutions to the problems that I've kind of seen in those respective districts. Then we need to see if we want to print that specific map in a document. So what manipulations are necessary? So if I am preparing a map for an external document for sharing with wider audiences, what are the changes that I can do in the map to make it more accurate, make it more context specific, so that in one view, I'm able to communicate the information that I want to show or discuss with the respective stakeholders. And then we'll also discuss some key design considerations that when you're creating your maps, what are the design considerations which you can take into account so that you're able to build context specific and useful maps for your own analysis. So today we'll break the demo into different parts. In the first part, we will do an overview of the maps interface. And then we will review the base map layer, how we can add boundaries, how we are selecting inputs for our specific map that we're trying to build, and how we can interpret a map legend when our map gets created through the Maps app. Then we'll also discuss the facility layers, how we can add facility layer to the map and how we can do filtering on the map that we just created. Then how we can overlap these thematic layers and try to find a relation between the data that we have plotted on these multiple thematic layers. Then we'll also have a discussion and demonstration on the legend options which are available in the maps, how we can use or change these legends, the difference between the predefined and the automatic legends which are available, and how data gets distributed across these legends. So we'll have a discussion and demonstration on that. Then we'll see the drilling down and drilling up function on the map and see how we can do that. We'll also focus upon the data table and downloading of maps into images and downloading the layer data of the map application. Then we'll have a look at the split view and the timeline maps, how we can utilize these different view options available for the data that we're trying to plot on the map. And in the last part, we'll cover the bubble maps, which have been just added as a new feature from version 2.35 onwards. So I'll log in into the DHIS2 instance now and take you through to the first part of the session, where we'll do an overview of the maps interface and move on with the next set of sessions and the practice exercises. So I'll just take you through to my DHIS2 screen. Okay, so I hope my screen is visible to all. So we have a dedicated Maps app as we had for our other visualization applications that we have seen over the course of the last week. So we click on the Maps application from the applications menu available in DHIS2, and we have this interface available on the default Maps app. So let's try to open existing favorite, and then we can review the Maps interface. So I'll go to the file and look for the favorite, which is already available. So let's have a look at the TP notified case new and relapse all forms. So this map kind of shows you the spread of tuberculosis cases, the notified TB cases in October to December 2020 by each district. Okay. So if you look at the interface, so on the left hand side, you'll see the layer which is available. So this is the thematic layer which is available, and this is the legend which is associated with this respective thematic layer. You'll see the map title here on the top, and the map display will show the values disaggregated by each district, because when I was creating this map, I selected that I want to see this data at the district level for my analysis for the last quarter. Okay. So let's edit this layer to review the layer selection options which are available. So if you want to edit an existing map which is available in the HIS tool, you click on this pencil icon. It shows you the edit options. So once you click on the edit icons, you'll see these different sections available for making the selections when you're creating any app in the HIS tool using the map application. So let's review the data section first. There are different items available here. So whether you want to plot an indicator or data element, or you want to do reporting rates, or you want to use program indicators. So we'll focus more on the indicator and the data elements selections here. Okay. Then you have an option to select the indicator group. So it is important that the indicators or data elements which you want to analyze through the Maps application, they need to be part of a group. So if your indicator or your data element, which you want to create, which you want to analyze on the Maps application, if they are not a part of the group, then you won't be able to make those selections here. So ensure that your data elements and indicators, which you want to utilize for creation of your maps, they are part of a group. If they're not part of these groups, then they are not available for these selections. Okay. So for example, if I select the TB indicator group, then I'll have these indicators which are already part of the TB indicator group. And then all the indicators which are part of this TB indicator group, they could be available for analysis. Okay. Now aggregation type is by default, it will take up the aggregation type which has been set for the data elements which contribute that indicator. So we don't need to change that. So we'll leave it as by data element. Okay. Period. So as we saw for pivot table and visualizer, we saw there are both the options available. One is to select relative periods, but then you also have fixed period available. If you click on relative, then you'll have the list of all the relative periods by the different frequencies available for analysis. So starting from daily, you goes into weeks, goes into months, it goes into years, by months, quarter, 6 months, year, financial year, 5 years. So depending upon the periods which are available by default, you get all those, all that information here. If you want to use a specific period, then you can select a period type, and then you get the list of options to choose from. So right now, this data is for October to December 2020. We can change that period and use January to March 2021. Okay. Then we switch to org units. Now, there are two ways in which you can select your org units. One is through the fixed options which are given here. Either you can select the levels at which you want to plot the data on the map, or you can even select these groups if you want to see data for a specific group of organization units only. Okay, so these are your fixed the parameters which you're passing when you're creating your maps. But if you want to create a map which is dynamic and it kind of is applicable to all the users in the system, then you can select these user organization units. So this is the same principle that we saw in a visualizer app. So when you're creating a dynamic chart which could be accessible by users at different level in the hierarchy, then you can select these user organization units. So if I have access to a particular province, then I'll only see the data for the districts which are below the province that I'm responsible for. Or if I am responsible for a district, then I'll only see data for the blocks which are below that district. Now, it also depends upon at what level you have configured your maps application, whether you have your polygons imported for block level as well. If not, then you'll not find any data getting plotted at that respective level. So depending upon how the GIS has been configured in your DHIS2 system, it would take up the plotting of data accordingly. Okay. So depending upon for what audience you're creating this respective map, you can choose the organization units here. So it could either be a fixed level at which you're plotting your map, or it could be based on the user org units, so you could make these selections here. Filters we'll not cover now. We'll see it in the later sessions where we can utilize the filter aspect. And style, we'll go into detail as we go ahead into different sections, and we'll see what each of these sections, each of these options contribute to. Okay. So let's try to change the org unit here, and let's see the data for districts in the animal region. So you're kind of adding a dual filter here. In the org units, where you're saying that you only want to see data for animal region and for the districts, so you can make a change here. So now if I put this chart on the dashboard, then this data would only be visible to the users who have access to the animal region itself or the district within the animal regions. For others in the food region, they won't be able to access this particular map because they don't have access to the animal region and its respective organization units. So when you're doing these fixed charts, you should understand that since you've pre-selected these values here, so these are kind of fixed to the users who have access to the animal region and the below districts which are there. Okay. Then we have altered some selections here. We have changed the period of this respective map. So we have taken Jan to March 2021. Org units, we have made the change. We have selected animal region, and within animal region we selected the district, and we have made no change to the filter and style. Okay. So once I have made these changes here, I can click on the update layer, and you'll see now the map has changed. It only shows me the data for the animal region and the districts which are there in that respective region. Okay, so likewise, you can edit your existing favorites and make changes to either the data, or you can make changes to periods, you can make changes to org units, and also to the filter and style aspects. The filter and style aspects we'll see later on in different examples how we can utilize that. So this is the basic interface which is available, and the period selections available in the system. Okay. So the selections which are available are your data, your period, your org unit, the filter, and the style. So we have covered these three right now: the data, the period, and the org units. And as you move forward, we'll focus more on the filter and the style aspects as well. Okay. So any questions up till now, please feel free to put on Zoom chat or the Slack channel so that we can answer those questions as we move ahead. Okay. Now, for example, we'll move on to the next topic where we'll see these different layers which are available. So now this was a pre-generated map which was part of our favorites which we opened. In case we need to start working on a new map, then we go to the file option and click on new. So this will kind of make your canvas blank, and you need to start from scratch to make a new application. Now a new map. Okay. Now we see here that these are base maps which are available. So I can switch between these base maps depending upon what particular base map I want to utilize. So the ones which are related to the Bing's map, they will get loaded automatically. If you have external base maps imported into your DHIS2 system, then you can use those external base maps also. Okay. Or if you do not want to use any base map, you want a white background, then you can click on this particular eye option. So this will disable any base map, and you'll have a white canvas to work with. Okay. Now let's look at the add layer button. So if you click on the add layer button, you'll see the types of layers which are available in the system, which we can use for plotting our data. Now there are thematic layers available, event layers available, tag identity layer available, facilities layer available, boundary layers available. So out of these, the ones which can be used in our aggregate data or thematic layers are facility layers and the boundary layers. Okay, events and tracked entities are more focused towards our in events or tracker data model. So we'll not have examples today for those. So these are part of the tracker level one course that we run, where we discuss how we can use maps into the events and the tracked entities. If time allows today, then I can quickly cover these. If not, then we'll focus more on the aggregate aspects. So if we have a look at the boundary layers. So boundaries are basically your geographical demarcations between different areas in your geographical hierarchy. So if you click on the boundaries layer, you'll see some selections available here. So depending upon the levels which you have defined in your hierarchy, you could select the levels here, and based on the availability of the shapefiles or the configuration which you have done in advance, these boundaries can be plotted accordingly. Okay, so country, region, district, these are basically your polygons, your broad geographic areas for which when you import the shapefiles into the system, these polygons also get imported and get associated to these respective provinces, districts, etc. And then these kind of form your broad boundaries. Facility is your point layer, which is basically your exact XY coordinates of that facility or hospital or a PHC. Okay. So let's select the district from here. And let's try to plot the district boundary. So if I select training land, I select the district from here and I click on add layer. So what I see is that I have my district boundaries plotted here. So within our training land instance, you have these districts, and each of the district has a boundary, which kind of helps us to demarcate the areas on the map. Okay. Now let's try to plot some data. So when you're plotting your data, you always use the thematic layer. Okay. So thematic layer, you can add multiple thematic layers, but one thematic layer can have only one particular data element or indicator which you can plot. Okay, so you can't plot more than one indicator on one thematic layer. So the ratio is 1:1. So each thematic layer will have data for either one data element or for one indicator. Okay, so let's click on thematic layer and we'll see this pop up there. We can make these selections. So let's try to plot an indicator now, a data element now. So we click on data element and we select the data element group. So you see in pivot tables and visualizers, there's an option to scroll through all groups. So you can see all data elements, all indicators which are part of your system. But in Maps app, you do not have the all option available. So essentially, the data elements and indicators which you want to plot on the map, they need to be part of any group mandatory. So you make sure that your data elements and indicators are grouped correctly so that they can be utilized on the maps application. Okay. So let's select the HIV data element group and let's look for HIV test performed. So I made my selections here in the respective data element. So I want to see data for HIV test performed. Okay. Now let's go to the period. Now here I want to see data relative. So I'll let it be relative and I'll see data for last 6 months. So I'll go down and select last 6 months. Now you see there are three display periods. One is single, one is timeline, one is split map. So we'll see timeline and split maps in the respective session when we cover these. So right now we'll let it be selected as single aggregate. Then we'll go to the org units and we will try to plot this data at the facility level. Okay. And we remove region from here. Okay. So I'll select the facility and filter and style, we'll modify existing map with the different options available. So filter we'll cover later. Let's come to style. So you see there are two options available here. One is choropleth, one is bubble map. Bubble map we have is a dedicated session. So by default, your style would be set to choropleth, which are basically your heat maps, or you can say they show us the data into different as a layer into different colors based on the legend which you have identified here. Okay. Then you have these two legends available. One is automatic color legend, one is predefined color legend. So automatic color legend is controlled through these color scales, which are already available, which are predefined into the system. So depending upon the indicator, which or the data element which you're trying to plot, you can use that. So if your data element is or your indicator kind of follows that, lower the value, lower the performance, or lighter the color, lower the performance, then you can use something like this. Or if it's opposite, where you want to see higher the value, higher the performance, then you can change the switch here. So lower the better, higher the better, depending upon how you want to visualize your data. So for example, mortality rates, you kind of want to show that the areas with high mortality rates should show up separately. And so depending upon your indicator definition, you can use these, the color patterns available here, okay? But if you have a specific color legend defined in the system for a specific data element or indicator, then you can use that, okay? So if your program has defined that these are the legends which you need to follow for a specific indicator, where you are defining the ranges on based on the understanding that we have within the program, then you could create these additional legends as well. Okay, so for example, for EPI coverage, if there are ranges defined that 0 to 60 is low, 60 to 80 is average, 80 to 90 is high, 90 to 100 is highest, and 100 and above is invalid. So these are the ranges which are predefined by the program, that this is how we would like to divide our districts based on their coverage performance. So then you could redefine these legends and use these legends while you are creating that specific map for your data element or indicator. So there are two ways to assign these predefined color legends. So when you're creating your indicator or your data element, as Pramil showed in his pivot table sessions, when we discuss the legend. So you can pre-assign a legend to an indicator or data element when you're creating that indicator or data element. So if a legend is pre-defined with the data element and the indicator, it gets automatically selected here. Or if you want to use a predefined color legend, then you can select from the list of legends which are already available in the system. Okay. Or if you want to use an automatic color legend, you can then use any of the color palettes which are available and are applicable to the indicator which you're trying to plot. Okay. Then if you're plotting data at the facility level, that means a point layer. So you are trying to map the data at the level of facility, which has a XY coordinate, and you want to show the radius of that respective health facility through the data. So if the data is high, then we can show bigger circles. So then the radius could be set from here. So if the data is less, then it can show the low radius. If the data is more, then it could show high radius, so that you could differentiate between the health facility based on the data which has been reported or the data volume which is available. Okay. So the by default, the radius of the point layer which gets created is 5 to 30, but you can change this when you're creating your map. And we'll see some examples where we change this respective radius, and you'll see that the radius of the point gets increased depending upon the volume of data available for that respective health facility. Okay. Then we have these labels option. If you want to show the names of the health facilities, then you can select labels. By default, it is set to no labels, but you click on it, then you could also modify the size of the labels, the color in which the labels need to show, and whether you want to italicize or highlight or bold that respective names of labels which you show. Okay. So we'll see show no data later. It has a significance with how you analyze the data on the map. So we'll cover this information later. So let's review once quickly what we have selected. So we have selected the HIV data element group. We have selected the HIV test performed data element. We have selected relative period for last 6 months. In the org unit, we have selected that we want to see data at the facility level. In the style, we have used the automatic color legend, and we have let choropleth be chosen in advance, and the radius we have just set to default values which are available. We're not using labels right now. So let's click on add layer to see the outcome of this respective selections that we have made. Okay. So now what you see is you see the data which is plotted for HIV tests performed at each health facility, and you could zoom in and zoom out. So if you hover over this respective health facility, so you see there are 19,943 HIV tests performed at this respective health facility. Then there are 32,489 tests performed. So now through the radius of this particular facility, the circle, you're able to see which facilities have performed the highest number of tests in this district and which have performed a lower number of tests. So based on the radius of the facility layer and the color gradient, you're able to highlight the highest performing and the lowest performing facilities in terms of, or if you can't say high or low, we can just say by the volume of tests which have been done at this respective health facility in the district, you can visualize this respective data. Okay. So this is how you can plot the maps at the facility level by choosing your indicator or data element and choosing the facility level in your organization units, and then assigning the respective legend which you want to use for this respective map. Okay. Now we'll cover one more concept here for equal counts and equal intervals. So if I edit this map again here, I'll go to style. You see the classification here, which has two options. One is equal intervals, one is equal counts. Okay. So both of these have a different significance in terms of how the data gets plotted on your map. So how the data gets distributed on the map. So when you talk about equal intervals, so what it would do is that it will try and distribute the range of values equally amongst your data, the total lowest and the highest range which is available, and how many classes of data is available in your respective legend. Okay. So now if I do a predefined color legend, the classes are already defined by me. So I want the classes to be 0 to 60, 60 to 9, say 60 to 80, and then I can say 80 to 100. Okay. So then these classes are being predefined by me when I'm creating this legend. But when you're using automatic color legend, you also need to define the number of classes. So by default, the number of classes would be 5. But if you want more, then you can make adjustments here as well. But based on the classification and the number of classes available, the system will try to distribute data across the data values available and how many classes are set here. So if I take an example, I have data ranging between 0 to 20,000. Then if I select 5 classes, then the data range for each legend would be separated by values of 4,000. Okay. So this is how the equal interval works. So based on the classes that I have selected, the intervals which I have selected, based on that and the number of values available or the data ranges available, from starting from the lowest to the highest, it will divide across these 5 classes. Okay. So right now the data which you see here is based on equal intervals. So if you see here, it will take up the lowest value, which is 105, and the highest value, which is 35,207. And it will try to divide the data equally between these respective classes. And then you'll see the distribution accordingly on the map. So 140 facilities have data between 105 to 7125.4. So the figure you see in the brackets is your number of facilities. Yeah. But in case you change it to equal counts. So now this is your decision based on the data which you're trying to plot, which is the best way to show the data, whether you would like to use equal intervals or you'd like to use equal counts. Now, when I select equal counts, the distribution will change here. Okay. When you use equal counts, they will try to distribute the data values based on the number of classes and the number of facilities available. Okay. So for example, if I have total 100 org units available or 100 health facilities available where I want to plot this data, and I have 4 classes, then each class will have around 25 values available. Okay. So if I switch this to equal counts, then it will see the number of health facilities which are available and the classes which are available. So it will roughly distribute the data between the division which comes out between the count of org units and the number of classes that I've selected. So if I take it to equal counts and click on update layer, you see the way the map, the data has been distributed now differs, and you see there is almost the same number of org units within each class. So 34 facilities lie between this, 33 between this range, 34 between this range. So it kind of has changed the way the data has been distributed across the health facilities, either based on the number of health facilities and the number of classes. So then it kind of switches to the equal count mode. But when you talk about equal intervals, then it kind of switches to the data which has been reported by these facilities and how it can be distributed between the class intervals which are available when you select equal intervals. Okay. So depending upon what's the best mechanism, the best way to use and interpret the map, the map that you're trying to create, you can switch between the equal intervals and the equal counts. Okay. Now, in the example that we were trying to analyze was the number of tests performed, and we are kind of trying to see the raw data values. So here we'll see that the equal intervals makes more sense because it kind of helps you to see the scale of difference between the tests which are conducted by each health facility or a group of health facilities. Okay. So equal counts might not really give us information because we're looking at facilities which are performing in terms of the volume of tests, whether they're doing good or they're doing bad, or they're performing adequate number of testing or not. So then equal intervals will make much more sense here. So we can switch to equal intervals and we can update the layer. Then it will give us a more tangible data which we can use to kind of understand the spread of testing across the health facilities in the district. Okay. So depending upon your type of data and how you want to interpret it, you can always switch between equal intervals and equal counts. Okay. So now you see here that the data is available through equal intervals. So you could see the disparity of data between each health facility. Okay. Because now the distribution has been based on the volume of testing which has been carried out, not the equal number of org units or facilities being pushed through the distribution. So now you're easily able to compare that this particular facility has performed a higher number of HIV tests as compared to this facility, which has done a lower number of HIV tests. Okay. So with raw data, when you want to see the difference between the scales of data volume between two health facilities or two districts, it's always prefer to use the equal intervals in such cases. Okay. So now I've created this app map, which now I want to save it as a favorite. So I can go to my file menu and click on save. And I can add in a name. I can say HIV tests performed. Performed by facility, and I can say last 6 months. Okay. And I can click on save. So now I have a favorite which has been saved by this name. And if in future, if I want to refer this favorite, I can go on the file menu, click on open, and look for HIV test cases, HIV tests performed. So there are a couple of more which are available. I think this is the one which I did. So we can just select this one. So you can again search for that respective favorite and refer back to the favorite that you created. So we've covered part one and part two of this session. So now, what we'll do is we'll go to the exercise document, which is available on EDX on the LMS. Please download that document, and there are exercises available for part one and part two. So let's take around 10-15 minutes to do that. And in the meanwhile, if you need a break, then you can also do that. So let's take 15 minutes to do part one and part two of the exercise, and let's regroup at 14:13 local time. So let's come back at 14:30 to proceed with the sessions next. And in the meanwhile, if there are any questions, I'll quickly go through Slack and try to answer those questions as well. So let's do the exercise and regroup at 2:30 local time.